Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears, we would know therefore what these things mean. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Here we have a battle that's going on between philosophies. There's two groups here, the Stoics and the Epicureans. The Epicureans base truth upon experiences, upon feelings, emotional, and it's of a sensual nature. The Stoics, on the other hand, those are the intellectual crowd. Those are the analytical, the humanistic ones. And they're indifferent to emotions and passions. And yet, here we have two extremes in philosophy, and Paul confronts both of them with the gospel. So, little sidebar here. It doesn't matter who you're dealing with, the fix for it is the gospel. This idea that somehow you have to tailor the message to the audience. No, you just preach the truth and let the audience, let the Spirit of God deal with the audience. Hebrews 10:38, the third time in the New Testament that God says this, now the just shall live by faith. But he concludes with this little, oh, by the way, he said, but if any man draw back, my soul shall not have no pleasure in him. Drawing back, pray tell, from what? Apparently, living by faith. When something creeps in and causes us to do something other than to walk by faith and trust God, then God says, I'm not going to have any pleasure in that. And yet that seems to be what's going on time and time again. New is defined, and it's used in our text a few times. New is defined as fresh, different, modern, contemporary. Now, you've been around for a while. Do any of those terms fall into the heading of positive in Bible-believing Christianity? I would say no. D.L. Moody said this. He said, I would advise people, if they think that the Bible is too old and worn out, when they build houses, not to put windows in them, but just to light them with electric light, because that's something that's new. Now, can you imagine if you had a house that didn't have any windows in it? Say, well, we don't want windows. We don't need windows. We have electric light. Yeah. When someone desires to seek some new way, it says something about their philosophical thinking, their reasoning. Jeremiah 6 and verse 16 says this, thus saith the Lord, so you know it's true. Stand ye in the ways and see and ask for the old paths, not the new paths, not some new thing, the old paths, where is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. There's the problem, a willingness. And we talked about that in Sunday school this morning. Part of our soul is, the operation of the soul is based upon one of the elements was will. We got a free will. And God said, this is what you ought to seek here in Jeremiah 6. But they said, no, we won't. Is that something for all the people out there that think that we don't have a free will? Well, these people did. They said, we will not. Believe me, we have a free will, and each one of us does what we want to do. Ecclesiastes 1 and verse 9 and 10 says, the thing that hath been, it is that which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun. Is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new? It hath been already of old time, which was before us. Someone has said, and I can't remember who the preacher was that said this, that spoke of the new morality. He said, the new morality is nothing more than the old immorality. You just put a new label on it. What we should be about new things is very cautious about instituting them. Because not everything that has new and improved attached to it, I mean, you could find that about every Bible that's out there trying to compete with this book. It'll say new and improved. Why, they couldn't even leave the King James Bible alone. They had to say the New King James Bible, hoping to draw people in on that. Chances are you could go to almost every product that you could pick up at the grocery store, and at least once a year, you'll find a new one pushing them over on the shelf, and this one will say new. In fact, we sometimes even get drawn in on that. We'll look at all of those flavors of cereal or whatever it is, and we'll go, ooh, look, that one's new. And what are we inclined to do? Try it. But let me give you some thoughts tonight on an individual or a group that would be in search of some new thing. You know, there's that old chorus that says that old-time religion is good enough for me. And you hear people today say things like, this is not your grandma's religion, as though grandma's religion was bad, or, you know, it was good enough for her. And if you have any good, positive thoughts about grandma, maybe it was that religion that did it for her. So why would you want to change it? But let me give you just a few things here. Number one, it tells me if someone's looking for some new thing, then they mustn't be content. Right? Doesn't that make sense? That person is not content. Paul said in Philippians 4:11, not that I speak in respect of want, which is, you know, where people of that philosophy would be. They want some new thing. He said, I'm not speaking in respect of want. He said, for I've learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. And so we're going to have good days, we're going to have bad days, but we don't need to throw out, what's that expression, throw out the baby with the bathwater? I was never inclined to do that. But well, whatever that means. I know this. Paul said in 1 Timothy 6, in verse 6 to 8, he said, but godliness with contentment is great gain. It is. He said, for we brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be there with content. I am generally a very content person. I do not yearn for anything in life. I think Kathy and I had the other day, we had a very busy day all day long, didn't have time to eat anything at all. This was Wednesday, she said, stop on the way home, stop at Firehouse and get something to eat there. I said, I don't have time for that. So I got home and I looked around and I said, well, I guess I'll just have a little peanut butter sandwich. Imagine that, Louis, the preacher having to eat peanut butter sandwiches. I don't care. I like peanut butter. I like peanut butter. If I really want to spice it up, I'll put some jelly on it. Yeah, I don't care. Yeah. Was it, I don't know, last night, the night before? You know, I had an egg sandwich. I don't care. I mean, if you want to give me a prime rib, I'll eat it. But if we're going to eat cereal, I'll eat cereal. I don't care. And how do you, I don't know, I don't think that there's certain people that that just fall into that category. I guess I've just learned that doesn't really matter. We're not supposed to eat to live. Or is that the other way around? No. We don't live to eat, but we eat to live. And so as long as periodically I can put something in the belly, I'm all right. But a person that would look for some new thing, particularly in the operation of the church, they can't be content. Because if, why would you change it up if you were content? 3 John says this in verse 9. I wrote unto the church, but Diotrephes, there's one of those buts, right? But Diotrephes, who loveth to have preeminence among them, receiveth us not. Why? Apparently he wasn't content. Wherefore, if I come, I will remember his deeds, which he hath done, prating against us with malicious words, and not content therewith. God even tells us he wasn't content. Neither doth he himself receive the brethren, and forbiddeth them that would, and casteth them out of the church. Beloved, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. So in the mix of all of that wordage, not trying to minimize what God said there, but what was the problem? He wasn't content. And he says there, follow not that which is evil, but that which is good. So I kind of take that a little bit as if you cannot learn, as Paul did, to be content, then that's not a good thing. That seems to be an evil thing. Hebrews 13:5 said, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. Why? And he gives the reason. For he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. And so that's the first thing that I would see about somebody wanting some new thing. And as I said this morning, you know, we can incorporate some things that maybe didn't work last year in our own personal lives and try to, you know, we looked at Hebrews chapter 12 to see some of those things. But we're not of the opinion that in order to see things get better, we'll say with the church, that we have to do away with the old methods and of doing things and incorporate some whole new operation, which is what a lot of churches are doing these days. I guess I've been doing this long enough now to, why would I change now? I mean, I would, if God said, everything you've been doing, son, is wrong, then I would change in a heartbeat. But if the world, and if all of you, for that matter, decided that you didn't want to go this way any longer, I'd wish you well and continue to do what I'm doing. Because this is not a popularity contest. I'm not looking, well, could I draw someone else in if I did this? Maybe if I sang and danced a little, maybe I could get more. Maybe I wouldn't. Maybe I'd lose. Or I'm afraid that if I don't change, so-and-so might leave, so I better change. Well, I've never played that game at all. I look at it this way, and you've heard me say this. The exits in the church are clearly marked. If you're not happy here, if this is not your flavor or whatever, there you go. There's a place out there somewhere. There's tons of them. But I'm content, and I trust that you're content too. I forget who it was. It might have been Lester Roloff that said, if you have to win them with a hot dog, it'll take a hamburger to keep them. And that's true. That's true. If you're buying, well, like the federal government, trying to buy the vote, you know, I swear in the next 2 years when we have an election, the scales will be tipped. There'll be so many more Democratic voters. Probably won't be many that speak English, but that's cruel, huh? Well, yeah, that's right. He speaks English. He's just late. No, I love you, brother. No matter what time you come. That's all. Yeah, they'll want something new if they're not content. They'll want something new if all of a sudden they decide that they need to challenge God's word. that they don't want to do it God's way. Then they'll want something new. It says in Acts 17 and verse 19 to 21, and they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine is whereof thou speakest is. Notice it's an attack on the doctrine. It's an attack on what foundational beliefs are. He said, if thou bringest certain strange things to our ears, we would know therefore what these things mean. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or hear some new thing. The first challenge was that of the Word of God. Goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 3. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made, and he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said? A better rendition. I'm surprised the serpent didn't say that. Eve, you've misunderstood. A better rendition of what God said would have been this. But she didn't need his help. She did it all on her own. Yeah, that's something to be said right there. That's what I'm saying. You'll seek some new thing when all of a sudden the way you're living or the way you're thinking doesn't coincide with God. Can two walk together except they be agreed? No. And God's not going to change. So there you go. James 1 in verse 22 to 25, but he said, be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any of you be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way, straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, in what? Therein the perfect law of liberty. He being not a forgetful hearer, because he could refresh his mind just by opening up the book, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. And so when someone starts, and it's not going to be, because the altering is not going to be the word of God. Because when you got saved, this book said what it said, and you believed it. What is going to change our belief about this book is our lifestyle. When we start doing things that don't coincide with this, all of a sudden, what we agreed with previously now becomes distasteful. Now we begin to question what God said. Well, it doesn't really mean that. Why? Because we're trying to justify what we're doing now, when it wasn't an issue before. Paul told Timothy, he said in 2 Timothy 4 and verse 2 to 4, he said, preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. And then he gives the reason. He said, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but will, he said, you know, and this is the sad part, and I think we're here, but who am I to get into the minds of everyone and say that that is the reason why they're doing this? But God's already indicated that as time goes on, he said the time will come, which means it wasn't then, but somewhere down the road it's going to happen. He said they're going to heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. They're not going to want to hear what God said anymore. They're going to want to hear what they want to hear. And if the preacher is going to continue to give them what the book says instead of what they want to hear, then they'll seek some new thing. It says he'll turn away his ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Now, who in their right mind would ever exchange the word of truth for fables? I love Romans 3 and verse 4. God forbid, yea, let God be true, every man a liar. And again, I've told you this many times, it's not that every man is a liar. But if you ever have to make a decision upon what God said and what someone else said, you better choose what God said. So thus far, we've seen two things. If someone is going to, a group, a church, an individual, a family, if they're going to alter and want some new thing, it'll probably be, number one, because they're not content. And usually discontentment is going to show up on somebody's face. Pastor Speroni can probably relate to this. Not probably, I know he can relate to this. See, we have the privilege, the painful duty sometimes, to be able to look in your faces while we're putting forth the Word of God. And we can see when people are just thrilled to death, you know, to be blessed by the Word of God. And they're smiling and they're happy and they're amening and all that. But then we can also see when it's not going over that well. And initially what we'll do is we'll try and we'll say, okay, maybe I'm not being clear enough. And then you clarify it a little bit and notice that the scowl has only intensified. So, you know, that's not the issue. They'll seek some new thing when they're not content and when they're going to challenge the Word of God. And you know, I mean, we've all heard this, that there are people who have certain pet verses in the Word of God. You know, judge not that you be not. God is love. You know. I mean, come on. I forget who said this, but they said that Christianity, modern Christianity anyway, in America is 3 inches deep and 3,000 miles wide. Oh, it goes from coast to coast, but it's not very deep. It's very shallow. And modern Christians are very easily offended. I've tried to think back over all the years that I've been saved and all the messages I've heard and preaching I've heard and all, and I've never been offended one time. Not one time. What, if the Bible said what it said, I don't take it out on the preacher. I don't take it out on the article that I'm reading or the devotion that for the day. I don't say, these people are nuts. Now, I could argue with maybe the manner in which it was said, you know. But if the Bible says what it says, every word of God is pure. You know? It's like the person that has a problem with being born again. Don't take it up with me. God said it. Let me give you the last part. And I hope we are content. And I hope we're not inclined to challenge God's word. But there are some people that are just looking for an opportunity to not continue. And believe me, and again, I think Pastor Speroni could relate to this, it's only a matter of time before you get the perfect cause to not continue. And it'll usually be something that the preacher did or didn't do. But count on it. It'll be something. If you're looking for an excuse, you can find one. That person doesn't really want to continue. And when they don't really want to continue, they'll look for some new thing. That's it. 1 John 2 and verse 19, they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would now no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. Paul told Timothy, in 2 Timothy 3:14, he said, but continue thou in the things that thou hast learned and been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. I mean, if you know what God said, and so if you weren't going to continue, we'll say here or wherever you are you expecting God to say it differently, do it differently somewhere else? That makes a whole lot of sense. Everything that God says, and he says these things over and over again in the New Testament. In Hebrews 13:1, he said, let brotherly love continue. Well, so-and-so didn't do this. Well, you know, he didn't say, provided that they show you brotherly love. No, you just do what you know is right to do. 1 Timothy 4:16, take heed unto thyselves and unto the doctrine, continue in them. He keeps saying over and over again. In Colossians 4:2, he said, continue in prayer. Continue, continue, continue. Sure, I'm glad. I look back over all the years now, and I remember thinking when I first when I first got saved. I got saved late in life. I was 29 years old when I got saved. And so it was really a milestone for me when I had been saved over 29 years. Because then I could actually say, I've been saved longer than I was lost. That's something. The song says, no turning back, no turning back. And having gone that far, no, I'm going to continue. He said in Galatians 6:9, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. And so I'll conclude on this thought. Men will seek a new way when they're not content. Men will seek a new way when they begin to challenge God's word. And men will seek a new way when they're unwilling to continue on God's directed path. Our text says that certain philosophers sought a new way. The thinkers. They think that they know better than God. Well, I sure am glad that someone introduced me to God's way. Because if I'd have continued on my way, I'd be lost, and who knows where I might be today. Romans 12:3 said, for I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. I think we all know about Proverbs 3 and verse 5 and 6. We're to trust in the Lord with all our, what else can you do? I mean, you could do some other way. But God's method, God's plan, God's directive is trust in the Lord with all thine heart. And then he said, lean not unto thine own understanding. Because there's always going to be a part of us, because of the way that we were taught, the way we were raised, the circle of friends that we have, there, those influences will always be something probably contrary to God. But he said, don't lean on that. Don't lean on that. In all thy ways, he said, acknowledge him. And he, God, he shall direct thy paths. Thank you, Jesus. Paul told Timothy in 1 Timothy 6:20, he said, matter of fact, there's a writing by this title, by this name, O Timothy. You know, if someone were to say to you like, oh, Louie, I mean, that's different than just saying, Louie. It's like, oh, it's kind of adding more of an emphasis, isn't it? Oh, Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust. And then he said, avoid profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science falsely so-called. Because we're drawn in, well, Dr. Bobblehead said this, and they've got a lot of letters after their name, so they must know what they're doing. I saw it on the History Channel. It has to be true. A&E reported. No. Beware of that. Beware of that. And then Paul wrote to the Colossians, and I'm done on this note. He said in Colossians 2 and verse 8 to 10, beware. That's a warning, right? Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. After the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. May the message you've